If you're already standing, please remain standing as we open up and continue in our study of the book of James. We're going to be completing chapter 2 this evening, a message from James that has so much impact for ourselves in our Christian life. So we're looking at James chapter 2, verses 10 through 26. James chapter 2, verses 10 through 26. If we can honor God's word by standing, we will read and we will pray. Beginning in verse 10, "For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. For he who said, 'Do not commit adultery,' also said, 'Do not murder.' And if you do not commit adultery but do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak, so act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy, but mercy triumphs over judgment. Verse 14, 'What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, if one of you says to them, "Go in peace, be warmed and filled," without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, "You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. And in the same way, was not also Rahab, the prostitute, justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead." Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we want to honor your word tonight. Lord Jesus, we thank you, Father, that we have this wonderful topic of faith. We thank you, Lord God, that it is only by faith, through the grace of Jesus Christ, that we are justified before you. That you, in fact, see us without sin. You see us as stain-free, as clothed in the pure linen of righteousness of the saints. And we thank you, God, that you have equipped us, you have gifted us with diverse qualities, with diverse characteristics, diverse gifts, in order to benefit one another as the family of God and ultimately be salt and light to a dark world. Lord Jesus, we don't want to take those gifts and throw them in a dark corner. Lord God, we don't want to use our righteousness for the gain of our own sin. Lord Jesus, we want to mature in the direction that you have called us to as a church. Lord, we thank you for vision, Father. We thank you for vision for this year. We thank you for a goal, Lord Jesus, to progress and run to. Lord, give us all that we need in energy and motivation to run that race of faith with endurance, with stability, with stamina, in order that we might properly be the example of Jesus Christ. So, Lord, we want to honor your word rightly tonight. Help us do that. Holy Spirit, speak. Holy Spirit, fill us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. What a wonderful, I just have to mention this. We have prayer at 6 p.m. before church. We just had an awesome time of prayer. Just the Holy Spirit was there. And for me, being able to come up and preach after that, it's just such an awesome thing to know that the Holy Spirit is here in our midst and he seeks to speak to you each as an individual, and then also as a body of Christ. Please pray for many of our pastors. We've been dropping like flies this week with sickness, illness. Well, we've lost two this week so far. Pastor Dan and Pastor Patrick are at home being taken care of by their wonderful wives due to illness. Would you pray for them if in your morning time of devotions or when you think of it? Also pray for Pastor Paul. He is just arrived into Colorado to meet his new grandson. So he's having a wonderful time, I'm sure, in like below 0 degree weather in Colorado. Sure, cuddling to the warmth of his new grandson. So pray just for a good, refreshing time for him as well. James chapter 2, verse 10 through 26. If I can kind of start this with an illustration. When Hannah and I were living in Germany as missionaries, we didn't have much in the way of TV entertainment, access to TV shows. When we would go to, we didn't have a TV in our home, not for any big spiritual reason, just for the fact that we couldn't afford one. And when we'd visit people's homes or on the off chance that we'd be able to catch like a Super Bowl in Germany or something like that, we'd be able to sit down and everything's in German, so it wasn't much of a point to own a TV for us as we were slowly learning German. But what we would have is we'd have our laptops and we would, you know, buy a TV show that we might like to watch on iTunes and watch that. However, one of the things that I loved personally watching at that time was a YouTube channel called, it was a guy who was called the Wood Whisperer. If you can imagine, you know, he was a carpenter and he built furniture. And I loved watching him go step by step. He was very meticulous in sort of showing how this is how you craft this and explaining how he built these beautiful pieces of furniture. And as time went on, he started to become popular and started to become sponsored by popular tools. So then he would give these review of these amazing, you know, skill saws, table saws, you know, wonderful, wonderful tools. And show how each of them worked. And I just loved it. I loved it for, I guess, sort of a unique way. I loved watching a guy create things. Because as far as my woodworking experience goes, it goes about to the extent of, you know, IKEA or something like that, where you would you know, just follow the almost the Lego steps of building something, and then I'd be proud of myself. And this show was intriguing, and it left me with a knowledge of a lot of things about furniture. After a few years of watching this guy, I could maybe have a discussion with a carpenter of how to build certain pieces of furniture. Because he was intriguing and he left me with a knowledge of many things about furniture. But when it came down to it, if you gave me the tools, the wood, the screws, the mineral spirits, the varnish, etc., and said, now build me a roll top desk, I would have no idea where to begin. I wouldn't know where to start. I had so much knowledge from watching this guy, yet I had no experience of putting that knowledge to application. In the realm of furniture building, I was a tragedy in knowing so much, yet in real experience and doing, I did so little. Now, with that illustration in mind, I want us to take a look at our scripture this evening. The first four verses, 10 through 13, are in a way the dovetail, the mortise and tendon, right? Between two pieces that join what James wants us to learn this evening about faith and works. Last week, we looked at the sin of partiality, how it affects our viewpoint of one another and ultimately of God. And how when we choose to focus on Christ, the Lord of glory, the result is our personal pride, our personal glory diminishes in light of His glory, and that really is our goal. Just as John the Baptist proclaimed, I must decrease in order that He must increase. And so that is our goal, Christ exemplified in us so that His glory shines. And when Christ is exemplified in us, what is the defining characteristic of who we are? It's His love. Therefore, we cannot show partiality. We cannot have favoritism of people that we consider successful or influential. For we know all of us are sinners in desperate need for a Savior. Now, James takes the next four verses and establishes that fact that partiality as a sin is just one component, one sin that makes us guilty of the entire law. Take a look at verse 10 through 11 together with me. He says, continuing on with the same argument that we looked at last week, verse 10, "For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. For he who said, 'Do not commit adultery,' also said, 'Do not murder.' If you do not commit adultery but do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law." James is teaching us, he's motivating us, encouraging us towards maturity. And for us to mature, we need to realize the reality of some things. It needs to come into clear view where we stand as human beings in the judgment of God. Now, what James is doing is he's preventatively stopping a practical but wrong assumption about degrees of sinning. Here's the wrong assumption that he's preventively coming against. This is the wrong assumption that so often we can misconstrue. We think of this when we are faced in temptation to sin. We can think of this in this way. Of all the sins in the world, all the capability of depravity and evil, when it comes down to it, partiality can't be that bad, right? I'm just showing favoritism. I'm just showing that I really like this one person over another. Partiality can't be bad in the realm of sin. It means, it's not as if I'm murdering someone. It's not as if I'm committing adultery with someone. James is preaching here a dynamic truth that must be understood. Every sin, big or small, separates us, separates me, separates you from the kingdom of God. If you have sinned, you are a transgressor of the law. It's very simple but profound. Sin makes us transgressors. Now, are there degrees of sin? Well, you know, John in his epistle says to the fact that there are some sins that lead to death and some sins that don't lead to death. But the profound dynamic of it all is all sin makes us a transgressor before God, and all sin separates us from God. Therefore, we need a blanket covering of all of our transgressions in order for us to be in right standing with Him. If you notice in just those first two words, we're entitled as transgressors of the law. Transgressor. Even the definition of transgressor has the idea of not just messing up once, but messing up to the furthest extent. I mean, just think about it. Break transgressor up in our English language. We cut it right down the middle. We have two words, trans, which means across or beyond, and gressor, we have aggressed or committed the first act of hostility against God. We have committed the first act of hostility of stepping over the line, the standard of God's righteousness, and said, because of this, I have gone far beyond that which I can come back to. There is no way that I can come back into right standing with God on my own because I've already gone the furthest I could possibly be. And friends, the moment that you suck breath into your life as you come into this world, you are a transgressor. Only Jesus is the way to find truth and life and a removal of that title of transgressor. The word itself tells us that we are guilty not just of one facet of God's standard, but all of it. Therefore, what we need is not a specific cure of one or two sins, not a Hail Mary, not praying the rosary, but in fact a blanket cure that removes all of our transgressions from us. The writer of Hebrews says this so beautifully, Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15. Therefore, he is the mediator of a new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, since a death has occurred that redeems them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. What was that first covenant? It's the law. The law that does its job very well in revealing to you and me, I do not cut it according to the righteousness of God. I cannot reach the throne room of God on my own progress. I must come to a mediator. I must come to a redeemer. And because of the death of Jesus Christ, I have that in one person, Christ Jesus, my Lord. So James charges us to say, friends, you who were once transgressors, if you're no longer a transgressor, why live in this way? Why live as if you are a transgressor? He charges us to not live as though we are still under the law of judgment, but rather we're under something so much more beautiful, so much more perfect. What James declares in verse 12, we are under the law of liberty. The law of liberty, verse 12 through 13 of James chapter 2. So speak, friend, brother, sister in Christ, so speak, so act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Every single one of us in this room, whether we're believers or not, are going to come under the judgment of God. For believers, we're going to be judged, but instead being judged from the law of judgment, we're being judged by the law of liberty. Notice that he does not say that we're under the law of license that gives us the ability to do whatever we want to do. No, we're still under a law. We're still under the command of obedience from God. But it's this wonderful freedom in the law of liberty that we're to live by. This is the law not of judgment, but of grace and mercy. This is not the law of legalism and aggression, but rather the law of love. And therefore, sins like partiality have no relationship with those who have experienced the grace of God. Why? Mercy triumphs over judgment. Do you realize that when we commit such a tiny, maybe obscure in our eyes, sin of partiality, that we are in fact being unmerciful to those that should receive mercy? We're being unmerciful to those that deserve our value, that deserve our time, that deserve our love that Christ has first shown us. Mercy will one day triumph completely over judgment. How? Because of the cross of Jesus Christ. And because mercy triumphs over judgment, we live as He lives. We no longer have to live under the thought of covetousness or pride to say that person has so much more than I do. Maybe if I sort of get in his way to find his success and his motive and suck all of that off of him, maybe I'll find some value and identity. Friends, in Jesus Christ, you've already found your value. You've already found your identity. And it's more valuable than anything that this world has to offer. I love, maybe some of you guys have the original King James version of the Bible that you're looking at this evening. God bless you. King James version has, I think, a wonderful line as the mercy triumphs over judgment. Instead of triumphs, it says mercy rejoices over judgment. Don't you love that? That mercy, by looking at judgment, mercy's response in kind of a anthropomorphic way, mercy responds, they say, I worship the Lord. I rejoice because the judgment that is coming towards me does not come upon me, but instead falls on the shoulders of my Jesus, my Savior. The victorious trumpet call of mercy is worshipful joy because Christ has taken our punishment for our sins. So why, friends? Why do we feel the need to transgress? Why do we feel the need to succumb to temptation? We do not need to live in that life anymore. Life isn't easy. Life is difficult. When we get up out of our beds, we know that we will face a day full of temptations, full of opportunities to succumb to temptation and to be distracted, confused, dissuaded, discouraged. because of sin that is an evil that is so rampant in this world. But we have a faith. We have a love. We have a mercy that this world does not understand. And because of that, we can actually find purpose by putting our feet on the ground off of our bed and say, today is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I know today mercy will triumph over judgment. I know today, without a shadow of a doubt, I was once a transgressor, but today I am now a saint under the living God. But we're charged. We're charged with a call of this law of liberty. What does this law of liberty expect of us? Well, it expects us to run with faith. It expects us not just to think, but to act in obedience and command of God's good service. And this is what James now takes us on the road with him together and teaching us. We want to find maturity. We want to find vitality. We want to find new life in Christ. This is how we find it as we discover verses 14 through 26 as we look at it. Let's just start with verse 14. A new argument coming from James, but connected to what we've previously looked at. Verse 14. He says, friends, brethren, brothers and sisters, what good is it if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? Let me read it one more time because this is the premise of what we're looking at for the rest of the evening. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? James begins his argument, his lesson for us to learn, with a thesis statement. Notice that? He begins almost like a dissertation, right? Of bringing, not a hypothesis, because he knows exactly what the application is, but he brings this thesis statement and says, boom, I'm going to now unfold to you how we're supposed to live under faith and works. He begins with this thesis statement that is necessary for the Christian to ask. And here is that question. Can a person who has no outside working of faith in his life actually be saved? Automatically, that brings personal evaluation, doesn't it? Automatically, that takes me, at least in my mind, to look at my heart of hearts, that secret place where only I and God stand, and say, Lord, what about me? Can I have no outside working of my faith evident in my life and consider myself to be saved by the blood of Jesus? More starkly, can a person who fails to show good works in his life have a faith that will save him at the day of judgment? It is a question that is necessary for all of us that are here right now looking at the scripture to ask ourselves. To ask that question. Beginning with this, first, we know that this epistle of James has a historical context. We know that James is writing from the perspective of a man who is an overseer in Jerusalem, who is part of this blooming, wonderful new work of the Holy Spirit called the church. That in the birthing of this church, God has instituted something that will continue on for the rest of eternity. This church, in a sense, born out of, but not conceived of, born out of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, is blooming rapidly. It's going towards the uttermost parts of the earth. And here is James at the very forefront, because Pentecost happened at Jerusalem. And he's there and he's working. And 3,000 of these people have gotten saved at Pentecost. And he's learning how to disciple and teach them. And he finds it necessary to write this, because never before has anyone ever heard that their sins were forgiven by God through one sacrifice. And because of that one sacrifice, no one had ever heard that they are now justified by faith, not by works. Since the beginning, it has always been works that a person must do in order to reach God. It was always sacrifice. It was always the slow progression of dying to self. It was always, always do this, do this, do this, and you will find yourself in the presence of God. For the first time, grace has been shown and made accessible to all who would receive. And that brought two results that we still face, even in the Christian church today, that are hindrances, I believe, to the church. The first thing is legalism. The second thing is antinomianism. Legalism is the belief of this: your salvation in Christ is solely based on your works. Therefore, ultimately, it's what you do that grants you access to God. This was prevalent within the synagogues of Jerusalem and the surrounding area of the Mediterranean as they witnessed Jews and Gentiles finding their faith in a Messiah, Jesus Christ, and now living in a life of grace. They said, well, that's all good and wonderful, but you also have to have this. You have to live this kosher lifestyle. You have to come to temple to sacrifice. You have to do this in order to get to God. And they would mix and match this to find some kind of conglomeration of what they thought was the way to live their life, but it ultimately became legalism. That's one side of the coin. The other side of the coin was antinomianism, the far end of the spectrum, were the result of people saying, we've experienced the grace of God for the first time, so that must mean works don't matter at all. I can do whatever I want to do. I can even have the license to sin because I know God's going to forgive me. Friends, this is the struggle that we face even today. I mean, you'll be amazed in the sense of discipleship and counseling and speaking with people within the church, where you can almost stem back to these two big things. Because a lot of us know the word, but a lot of us use the word for our own devices and our own desires, whether it's legalism or antinomianism. So this is what James and the apostles were contending against right out of the gate. So James is answering this question: friends, do works matter in the life of faith? And here he does, in a very teachable way, give us an example of what dead faith is, verses 15 to 17. He says, if a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warm, and be filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. Now here's the relationship between works and faith shown wonderfully in just this example. James is now going to show us the relationships of works and faith in the life of a believer. Notice in the example, works, what we do in obedience to God as believers in Jesus Christ, reveals how alive our faith is. What we do reveals how alive our faith really is. Notice that James's example is within the realm of the church. It's the fellowship of believers. Look at the example. It says, if you find a brother or a sister, a fellow Christian who's poorly clothed, a fellow Christian that hasn't eaten in 4 days, a fellow Christian that might have lost their job, have no roof over their heads, trying to provide for their children. And it says, if you see them, your brother and sister, within the body of Christ, where perfect unity should be, and they have evident need of food and clothing, if you overcomplicate things, over-spiritualize things, to say, hey, brother, I'll pray for you, you have failed in your obedience to Jesus. We ultimately fail to show the vitality of our faith by giving what we have to our brothers and sisters in need. After Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, this wonderful verse shows up. It says, and within the body, everything was common together. There was no lack, because everybody shared in what they needed and what they had. And it was this wonderful picture of unity under Christ Jesus. And so James is warning us in this way because he's one of the first writers. James' epistle here is one of the first epistles to come out in the apostolic church. And he says, already we're starting to fail. Already we're starting to look at works and say, forget it, I'd rather over-spiritualize it and just think good thoughts rather than actually doing good things. Sometimes, friends, the simplest practical thing is actually doing what God says. Obeying what God tells us to do. We can know a whole lot about God. I can know a whole lot about God. We can sit around and discuss the Word. We can sit around and mull over theology. We can mull over doctrine. We can mull over all these different things about God, what faith is and what faith does, how faith justifies. But if we do not act on faith, we have failed and our faith is dead. Back to that illustration, you know what? I know a lot about woodworking, but I've never put it into practice. So don't you dare trust to sit in any chair that I might have made, right? Why? Because I haven't properly done what I'm learning in mind to do. This example is so clear and it's so practical. Serve your brothers, serve your sisters. Think of them above yourself. Ask if they have needs. Ask if you can pray in that direction. And if you can satisfy that need, to satisfy it. Why? Because Christ is shown in that. The love of Jesus is shown in that. James continues with his argument, verses 18 through 20, and he says, now I know some of you might think this, but some of you will say, verse 18, you have faith, brother, and I have works. Show me your faith, is his response. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one? Hey, listen, you do very well. But friends, even the demons believe, and they shudder. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? James again preventatively shatters the argument of faith without works. For someone to say that they have faith apart from works, which he kind of has this illusionary person saying, he's saying, listen, I have faith and you have works. We're all going to get along together. He says, friends, that's self-defeating even. Just that statement that you have faith without works is completely self-defeating. Logically, it's a wrong statement to say. Because you say you have faith, but you demand that I simply take your word for it. There is no tangible evidence to know that you have faith unless I see you serving your brother and your sister. Actually coming alongside in exhortation, coming alongside in service to one another. Until we see sacrifice, how can we understand what faith is all about? There's no evidence to show me that our faith or your faith, or my faith, is alive unless I'm doing something about it. Now we need to take a step back here because looking at verses 18 through 20, James kind of somewhat possibly, seemingly, but untrue, contradicts that wonderful promise from Paul's epistles in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Paul seemingly contradicts James when he writes that we are saved by grace through faith, not by works, lest any man should boast. That's absolutely true. I am saved. My salvation hinges upon the grace that God has given me through faith. I'm justified by God through faith, not by works, lest any man should boast. But friends, I want to tell you that they are not contradicting themselves at all. Why? The faith that saves you must be alive. It can't be a dead faith. It can't be a wounded faith. It cannot be a sick faith. That faith needs to be alive for it to work. I don't get why people would think that James and Paul are contradicting each other when they effectually are saying, possibly, I think, the very same thing. Turn with me real quickly. Look at Ephesians chapter 2. We tend to take verses 8 and 9 and just kind of keep it there and don't look at the rest of the thought that Paul is declaring. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. Let me read it for you. It says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, yes and amen, and this is not your own doing, yes and amen. It is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." And here's verse 10 for the emphasis, "For you are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for" what? You've been created for "good works, which God prepared beforehand that you should walk in them." Friends, you're the workmanship of Christ. You're his poem. You're his wonderful artistry. And you have a purpose to accomplish in this life. And if you waste your life sitting on a couch, your faith, friends, is dead, because you never fulfill the intended purpose that God has for you. And your life is meaningless. Life can be so rich when it's simply saying, "I'm going to follow the will of God today, tomorrow, for the rest of my life." The freedom in the law of liberty is indulgent when we do the works of Jesus. Because this is the great danger of a Christian who believes themselves to be a Christian because 10 years ago, they said some words, they prayed a prayer, then based on that, went on with their lives expecting that when they meet God, they'll be justified. James tells us that that person's faith is dead. He gives us this sobering realization. Hey, you said some words a long time ago. You said you believe. Hey, you did a good job. Guess what, though? Demons believe, and they shudder, and still they face an eternity of punishment. Even that, to me, is interesting, because at least if you know, God forbid, we could visually see a demon shuddering before God, at least that shows me physical evidence that he believes, because he's quaking in his boots. He believes in God, yet he has no salvation in him. We might have some emotional response in the past, and I'm not saying emotions are bad, but when you take your entire life of salvation in Christ and base it upon some emotive experience, friends, I got to tell you, there's so much more to faith in Jesus than that. There's this wonderful daily walking with him. There's this wonderful reliance upon the intimacy of the Holy Spirit to speak and say, "Lord, give me any opportunity to do what you want me to do, because I want to do good works for you." Finding this closing his argument here in verse 21 to 26, James gives us two accounts to really kind of set all of these things home in living a life of faith producing works. He gives us one account that's negative, of faith without works, and now, which was the one where we say be warmed and well fed, now he gives us a positive example. He gives us a positive account of living faith and works. Actually, he gives us two. Verse 21 to 26. He says this, "Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. He was called a friend of God. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. And in the same way was not also Rahab, the prostitute, justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead." He says this first with Abraham. He says, Abraham was justified by faith long before the sacrifice of Isaac. He mentions this. He, in fact, quotes in verse 23, Genesis 15, verse 6, by saying, "He believed, and it was counted to him as righteousness." He had faith. But it was the demonstration of his faith by putting his son upon the altar of God, having the knife in his hand, knowing that God would provide a way for sacrifice, yet still being obedient. That was the demonstration, not only to himself, not only to his son, but in all of this grandeur to God himself, to say, my faith is active and living because I trust the God of heaven and earth more than I even trust myself. Verse 22, those action words jump off the page, don't they? Look at that. His faith was active. It was completed. Notice that. Because he acted and completed his obedience to God. He fulfilled what God told him to do. Friends, this is what Colossians 3 is all about. Colossians 3, many of us know this text, verse 1 and 2. If you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things that are above and not on things that are on the earth. It says seek. Seek these things that are above. Your life is seeking that which is above until you actually are above. Being in his presence, coming into that inheritance, coming into that throne room. The second example is Rahab, because we need to close, so we move a little bit faster. Second example is Rahab. Here's a woman that many people identify her as a prostitute, and she obeys God. Number one, she's a Gentile, has no connection to the God of heaven and earth except being created by him with value and purpose in his image. Gentile, sinner, prostitute, didn't know a thing about God, yet because of the example, because of the works and the living faith of the Jewish nation of Israel, she said, that's a God I can trust, and obeyed him when even not knowing him personally. She was faithful to work even at the possibility of her own expense. So here's a Jew, Abraham. Here's a Gentile, Rahab, both exemplified as having a living faith testified in Hebrews 11, the Hall of Faith chapter. And so the lesson of that is very clear. If we believe in God, we will do what he tells us to do. And if we believe in God with the help of his people, we will do even what he wants us to do at our own expense. In the concluding verse, Hebrews 11, verse 1, this is what faith is. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Those big words there, assurance and conviction. Assurance and conviction brought together will breed action. I'm assured that what God says he is true. And because of that assurance, I'm convicted then to respond to a God who has assured me that he says what who he is and what he has done is true. I'm convicted to live that life of faith. Faith in the obscurity, the day in and day out of things, in order that I might work the good works of Christ. Why? Because I'm his workmanship. I have so much more value than what the world has to offer. You have so much more value than what the world has to offer. And the question that is laid before you is, how alive is your faith? We simply have to find out by being obedient. Amen. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, Lord, there's nothing that we can do outside of you, Lord God, that brings us into that place, into that presence, unless your Holy Spirit comes and speaks to us. Lord, we thank you for your scripture this evening, Lord God. We thank you for your voice, knowing that it will succeed from that which it has sent to do, because it will never return void. Father, I pray that in these words that James, through the influence of the Holy Spirit, you would challenge us to say, today I'm willing to take risks for the Lord God. I'm willing to possibly suffer embarrassment by asking this person that they have peace with Jesus. Because I know that through the unction of the Holy Spirit, Lord Jesus, you will have your way, you will have your glory, and my faith will be revealed. Lord, we know also in Scripture that the revealing of our faith often happens in the midst of trials. Lord Jesus, show us and teach us how to use trials in our life to bring about your glory. Lord, we want to say tonight that we're satisfied in you. We trust in you. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that you've designed us, you've equipped us with all that we need to accomplish your works here on earth. Let your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven, Lord. We thank you for tonight, Lord. Commend us towards maturity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.